Welcome to the APGO Basic Science Objective video about abnormal genetic or aneuploid screening. The objectives for this APGO Basic Science video are: describe the process of oogenesis and meiosis leading to a haploid gamete. Recognize how abnormalities in chromosome number occur, particularly in relation to maternal age. Compare and contrast how various perinatal aneuploidy screening tests identify aneuploidy in fetal DNA, first and second trimester screening tests, and circulating cell-free DNA. And finally, counsel a patient on the diagnostic tests for fetal aneuploidy available during pregnancy. This is Anna Marie Anders, and she is 8 weeks pregnant. Ms. Anders is considered advanced maternal age. She's at her doctor's office waiting to see her OB-GYN. Given Ms. Anna Marie's age, there are some important discussions she will have regarding aneuploidy screening. But before we can talk about counseling her, let's get to the basics. By the time a female fetus is 10 weeks, there are identifiable ovaries with cortical cords. By 16 weeks in utero, each primordial follicle in the cortical cords has an oogonium, which will become a primary oocyst when it begins the first phase of meiosis. Remember that the primary oocyte arrests in prophase of meiosis 1 in utero and will stay that way until puberty. At puberty, one or more follicles is stimulated to complete meiosis 1 with a surge of LH during the menstrual cycle. With the release of the first polar body, the chromosome complement is now haploid. The haploid oocyte now goes through mitotic division and will arrest in metaphase and be expelled as a mature oocyte. It remains arrested in metaphase of the second meiotic division until fertilization occurs. With fertilization, the haploid oocyte and spermatocyte combine to form a diploid cell once again. Errors in meiosis can lead to an abnormal oocyte, which may produce gametes with an alternation of chromosome number called heteroploidy. Heteroploidy may occur through non-disjunction in either the first or second mitotic division. Non-disjunction is the failure of one or more pairs of homologous chromosomes, or sister chromatids, to separate normally during nuclear division, usually resulting in an abnormal distribution of chromosomes in the daughter nucleus. Now let's pause, think, and apply. What are the five common aneuploidies resulting from maternal mitotic non-disjunction, which may result in a viable fetus in the mid-trimester? The answer is trisomy 13, Patteau syndrome, trisomy 18, Edwards syndrome, trisomy 21, Down syndrome, 45X, Turner syndrome, or 46XXY, Klinefelter syndrome. What puts Anna Marie at higher risk for these events, simply put, is time. The older the mother, the more likely you are to see non-disjunction and a failure of a chromatid to separate. What can we offer Anna Marie in terms of early testing for aneuploidy? There are several options, both invasive and non-invasive. When considering the pros and cons of invasive versus non-invasive testing, it is important to consider what kind of information the test will give us. The non-invasive tests are limited in the disease process for which they can screen. Although the screening panels are ever expanding, let's look at each one. Choices of non-invasive testing include first trimester screen, quad screen, cell-free DNA. First trimester screening includes nuchal translucency measurement, maternal serum free beta human chorionic gonadotrophin, or beta HCG, and pregnancy-associated plasma protein, or PAP-A, levels. HCG is a placental hormone initially secreted by the syncytial trophoblasts in the conceptus, and PAP-A is the largest of the pregnancy-associated proteins produced by the embryo and the placental syncytial trophoblasts during pregnancy. Using a combination of analyte levels and NT measurements, a risk estimate for trisomy 21, 13, and 18 is calculated. Factors such as maternal age, prior history of aneuploidy, weight, race, and number of fetuses are also included in this calculation. The maternal serum quadruple screen is used to give the risk for trisomy 21, 13, and 18, an open neural tube defect. It is a measurement of four maternal serum analytes. HCG, alpha fetoprotein, which is produced early in gestation by the fetal yolk sac and then later in the liver and the gastrointestinal tract. Inhibin A, an unconjugated estriol, which is synthesized in very high quantities by the placenta. These four analytes, in combination with maternal factors such as age, weight, race, presence of diabetes, and number of fetuses, are used to calculate a risk estimate. If a woman has a first trimester screen, she would not necessarily need to obtain a full quad screen, as the complete first trimester screen has a higher detection rate than the quad screen alone. She would still be offered a maternal serum, AFP, to obtain a risk for open neural tube defect. Utilizing the first and second trimester screen together to calculate aneuploidy risk is less often used and requires more detailed genetic counseling. Cell-free DNA evaluates short segments of DNA in maternal blood and can be used to screen for a variety of fetal conditions. The fetal component of cell-free DNA is released into the maternal circulation primarily from placental cells undergoing apoptosis or programmed cell death. Cell-free DNA testing has a much better sensitivity and specificity and detects various forms of aneuploidy, including sex chromosomes. Now let's pause, think, and apply. Think fast. Your patient wants to pursue testing for fetal aneuploidy. What is the difference between screening versus diagnostic testing? A screening test may be based on multiple factors and will only assess the risk that a fetus will have aneuploidy. The screening test cannot confirm or rule out the presence of aneuploidy, and a high-risk result should be confirmed by a diagnostic test. There are both false positive and false negative results. A diagnostic test, most often offered to mothers determined to be at high risk for aneuploidy, assesses whether aneuploidy is present or absent in the developing fetus by directly evaluating the fetal chromosomes. After an abnormal non-invasive testing, or in patients who desire a definitive diagnosis, the option for prenatal diagnostic testing includes invasive methods, chorionic villi sampling, and amniocentesis. CVS is generally performed between the 11th and the end of the 13th week, or amniocentesis done between weeks 16 to 22. These tests allow for the evaluation of actual DNA structures and gives a definitive diagnosis for a patient. It can also allow for evaluation of translocations and screening for specific gene sequences or mutations. Since actual DNA material is obtained, this is a definitive diagnosis. However, the invasive testing comes with a risk of pregnancy loss approaching less than 1% for CVS or less than 1% for amniocentesis. Non-invasive tests do not confer these risks to the pregnancy, but it is important to remember that all of the non-invasive screening tests are not diagnostic and should be followed with an invasive test if definitive diagnosis is needed prior to an intervention. Anna Marie is considering her options and, given her gestational age, has time to think about what would be best for her. She may also desire to speak with family, friends, a genetic counselor, and her physician again to help her make a decision. This concludes the APGO Basic Science video on abnormal genetic or aneuploid screening. You should be able to describe the process for meiosis, understand how chromosomal abnormalities occur, and compare and contrast between diagnostic and screening tests for aneuploidy.